what a magnificent sight that is. What a graceful and stunning aircraft to start the first day of this 16th Air Festival here in Bournemouth. One of the most famous and successful Royal Air Force heavy bombers of World War II. Massive legend that lives on through the work of the Battle of Britain Memorial Flight. Of course, it's been a tough year for them, and we think of the troubles they've been through during the course of this summer. Following on from the failed design of the Manchester, Roy Chadwick put his thinking hat back on again and came up with this remarkable aircraft, which first flew from Manchester on the 9th of January 1941. That was just a couple of years, of course, after the war itself had started, and then 2 years before that, so the most populous aircraft in the Royal Air Force was actually the Blenheim bomber, and was that one being far superseded. And with a bomb load that was fully tanked up, it had a range in excess of 1,500 miles. Over 7,000 Lancasters were built between 1941 and 1946. Of those, many thousands were lost on operations, and another several hundred lost on written off in various crashes. And only two remain airworthy today. The other one being in Canada. Back in 2014, we had the pleasure of flying those two aircraft together in and around Bristol. Presence, performance, ruggedness, reliability, and as you can see, sheer charisma endeared it to its crews who were proud to fly this famous thoroughbred. In the hands today of Flight Lieutenant Seb Davey, bomber leader as he's known up on the flight, local lad from up there from Merseyside, an aerospace systems engineer at heart, graduating from nearby Southampton University, with many, many hours under his belt. Crews coming back with a serious amount of damage, limping their way back across the English Channel to find the mess. Alongside Seb today, squad leader Matt Moore. He joined very early, age just 16, flew solo for the first time in his life, a PT, a flying scholarship at PPL at the age of 17. Now for its final pass, an opportunity to recall the motto of the Battle of Britain Memorial Flight, lest we forget, and don't let us. In total, some 125,000 aircrew served in Bomber Command during World War II. Over 73,000 of them became casualties, killed, wounded, or shot down. Final pass for the Battle of Britain Memorial Flight, the Lancaster.
interesting and alarming pattern for today's display. Of course, some more jumpers exiting after him as well. They're all going to be doing their own thing. They've all got their own plans as to what they're doing. And you may also see two canopies opened much higher up. I'll bring you back to those later on. So like I said, that's the jump master opening nice and low for us all. And what he's going to do is he's going to set the landing pattern for today's display. So he's making his assessment off the smoke that we've got on the ground with us, judging how strong that wind is, and off of that he's going to decide where he needs to turn to get as close to that cross as he can. Now the cross isn't a target for the team, although they do like to try and hit it when they can. However, the main purpose for the cross is an indicator to them up in the plane that it's safe. So don't give them any hate if they miss that cross, but they will do what they can to put it nice and close to it. So first person down then. Jump master for today's display, we have Lance Corporal Ollie Goss, right on the cross for you all. Coming down behind Ollie then, we have the wingsuiter for today's display. Got out first for you all. Coming down right behind Ollie, we have Corporal Stephen Hanley. Following in behind Steve then, we have the jump master from the last couple of years, we have Corporal Mike French. If I can bring all your attentions back up towards where the plane was, you can see one of those canopy formations that I was talking to you about. We have what we call a bi-hand, so there's two canopies that are connected up together. So what they did, those are the two canopies that pulled their parachutes as soon as they exited the plane. And what they did is the first person will exit, the second person will exit straight after them. And then from there, as soon as the second person pulls their parachute, the first person is going to pull it on them. That will keep them in close vicinity to each other once they've pulled their parachute. From there, they're able to crash into the back of each other and manipulate their canopies against each other as they're doing now, downplaning directly overhead and bringing their parachutes nice and quickly down to the ground overhead for you all as they just did there. This allows them to split nice and low for you all as they did, and then they're going to also land simultaneously for you and put on a good display for you all. Whilst I was talking to you about that, we also had two other canopies land. So we had flying the Bournemouth Airshow flag. We had Lance Corporal Adam Bellingham.
Displaying the Tudor requires careful energy management due to its low power to weight ratio. When not displaying, Bob is a qualified flying instructor on 115 Squadron based at RAF Wittering. There he trains the future generation of Royal Air Force pilots, as well as converting frontline pilots into QFIs, called Qualified Flying Instructors. He's amassed over 8,000 flying hours on 15 different aircraft types. Great to watch now, the completion of his slow roll. Can be a tricky maneuver, that, and it requires skillful handling, coordinating elevator, rudder and aileron, all while trying to keep the aircraft straight down the fly line. Top speed of 212 miles an hour, Spain is flight 180 degrees back towards you. It's all slightly different, as that is to connect him with the flight path. Remember, this carbon composite aircraft, 180 horsepower Lycoming engine. Putting it now into a stall turn at almost zero airspeed at the top there. It's operated by number 6 Flying Training School in partnership with Babcock International Group, primarily flying University Air Squadron cadets and RAF cadets. 13 Air Experience flights across the UK that offer up to 20,000 cadets a chance to fly every year. And you can join the cadets yourself if you're between 12 and 17 years old. by the tutor, an experienced aerobatic manoeuvre such as Bob is flying here today. Four-point roll now going through. Delicate use of the rudder whilst supporting the nose above the horizon here, flying at various degrees of bank. If you looked underneath there, you would have seen the Royal Air Force Benevolent Fund heart on the belly of the aircraft. Of course, provide a huge opportunity for personal development, as well as a wide variety of adventure training in UK and expeditions across the globe as well. Members not committed to a military career after graduation. So a chance to get a bit of free flying from the sound of it. Again, back up into another loop here, checking over his shoulders, looking back at the horizon, going through 5G, aiming to pitch the aircraft through that imaginary circle in the sky. Even when inverted, the central fugal force is still keeping pressed into his seat. Positioning now for a half Cuban. Going for another roll instead. Again, these guys got a bag full of manoeuvres and are just adjusting for the wind and conditions on the day. The Royal Air Force, as you're aware, is recruiting for multiple rewarding and demanding professions, and there's an exciting future for the continued development of our combat and maritime patrol aircraft in UK space. That is certainly something special indeed. So the aim of the charity supporting us here today alongside the frontline Royal Navy, the Fleet Air Arm, aiming to inspire future generations to of course remember the service and sacrifice of those involved with naval flying and promote a deeper understanding of the important part played by the Royal Naval Air Service and the Fleet Air Arm in the history of our country. The charity itself is funded entirely by private donations, needing of course your support to keep these venerable aircraft in the air. Undergoing restoration, a Supermarine Seafire, the Wasp you see here today, a Harvard, a Stinson Reliance, a Tiger Moth, and wouldn't it be great to see the Seahawk and the Sea Fury back in action again. Like so many other historic flights, they of course use chipmunks as well, and that is essentially for tail wheel training. Very shortly to the end of the four ship formation. With us now for the break.
Toronto Sapphire, break.
Painted in the colours of HMS Aurora's Wasp flight, the Aurora itself was a Neanderthal frigate. His previous role when serving was flying Sea Kings. Retired from the Navy, went on to fly many types and had over 30 years with British Airways flying most sorts of Boeings before coming back and flying with the Heritage Flight itself. Originally called the Sea Count, this was developed alongside the Army Scout helicopter. It was one of the world's first frigate-based helicopters. See the unique differences here between the Army Scout and this aircraft, and that of course is this one has wheels on it for easy maneuverability around the deck of ships, and had a different weapons fit as well. rasping sound there coming from the Borsworth. Interestingly enough, the first missile powered by the Royal Navy Anger was from a Wasp in the Argentinian conflict back in 1982, fired against a submarine, the ARA Santa Fe, during the Falklands conflict. The missile hit the submarine, preventing it submerging, and thus the sub was captured, enabled the ground troops to continue their operation. But the Wasp also served with many other navies around the world, New Zealand, South Africa, Netherlands, Malaysia, Indonesia, and Brazil. Eventually retired from the Royal Navy, or the New Zealand Navy, in 1998. Tim coming in now to the hover, just do a few pirouettes in front of you. Immediately displaying a rearwards transition. Can be a little tricky depending on the wind, but in his hands very safe indeed. And you can see a fair amount of downwash down on the sea itself. You carry four passengers. Generally it's a crew of just two, one pilot and one air crewman who was also the missile aimer. Hit him with a hook for underslung loads and a wing for missile work and search and rescue, of course. But that folding, that bulbous sort of canopy you see in the main cabin itself, that was designed specifically to be wide enough to enable the stretcher to be fitted across the back seat. To as the ship's Land Rover, capable of course of a lot of utility work, as you can see from that, a very strong and bulbous fuselage. Tim just coming to the end of his display here, with an RF Nimrod high above, adding extra protection, but was gradually replaced from the late 1970s with the introduction of the Westland Link. During its various times and deployments, it deployed with many ships, but let's focus now on this wonderful machine you see in front of us. A stunning and venerable swordfish. Evolving initially from the prototype Fairey TSR-2, the torpedo spotter reconnaissance, designed initially by Labelle and Chaplin of the Fairey Aviation Company. It first flew in 1934, entering service with 825 Squadron in 1936. Over 2,300 of these aircraft were built, first 600 or so by Fairey Aviation, and the remainder under the Blackburn Aircraft Company at their workshops up in Sherburn in Elmet in Yorkshire. Unsurprisingly therefore, the Blackburn built aircraft became officially known as Blackfish. most remarkable thing about it very much being its entire longevity. By every other normal standard, was declared, or it would have been obsolete at the outbreak of World War II, but confounded everyone by remaining in operational service throughout the whole of the war, and gaining distinction of being the last British biplane to see active service. Indeed, outlasting its intended replacement, the Albatross, which disappeared from frontline service in 1943. In the hands today of Andrew Davis and Mark Jones, flying on behalf of Navy Wings. In 1945, the Swordfish saw active service afloat and ashore in every theatre of war between the Atlantic and the Indian Ocean, the Equator and the Arctic Circle. But it was in the Atlantic, that this venerable iconic biplane really proved itself as one of the greatest aircraft in the history of naval air warfare. Helping us celebrate, of course, D-Day at the same time, the 80th anniversary this year, with the markings clearly seen on the wings. Helped defeat the U-bite threats and dramatically stemmed convoy losses, turning the tide of the war. Big Pegasus engine on the front there, considered cutting-edge technology back in the mid-1930s, but really only propelled the aircraft at a stately 90 knots cruise, when lightly laden, and about 82 knots with a torpedo underslung. Total crew of three, not given a great deal of comfort, no heater, just fabric covering and open cockpits, little shelter from the cold and wind and rain. But as you can see, a surprisingly maneuverable aircraft. And perhaps that's what really led it to its survival, because enemy guns found it very difficult to set their sights on such a slow maneuverable aircraft. Getting back on the speed now, into wind a little bit as well. Andrew bringing the speed way back, just showing just how slow this can fly. The wings would of course fold to minimize room taken up in the ship's hangar. The undercarriage was designed very much to adopt a firm arrival on the heaving flight deck of the ship. Eyes left and low this year, having won the steepest sword at Riyadh earlier this year. It's time for the Black Cats from 825 Naval Air Squadron. Started many years ago as the Big Pair, having been replaced by these tricky aircraft, and black catting, a bit of naval slang for you there, and maybe getting one over on your oppo, doing better than somebody else. That's where that comes from, but also of course one of the squadron badges featuring that as well, 825 squadron itself, the parent squadron. Leading the team today is Lieutenant Michael Vivian, known as Viv, and alongside him his wingman, Lieutenant Scott Sunderland, Scotty, to everybody else. They're just completing their Canadian break, rolling away from us, positioning out for another wing over. Armed with a range of weapon systems, from snipers, 50 cal machine guns, torpedoes, the Martlet missile and the Sea Venom missile, the Wildcats gives the Navy a full range of anti-surface, anti-drone and anti-submarine capabilities. Squadron itself responsible for training all Wildcat pilots and observers, and the management of all the flights. Remember, they're all dispersed across various frigates and destroyers around the world. Nose down. Really interesting position to be in when you're looking at it. Literally canopy full of seats. Nothing new to these guys, of course. They cut their teeth rolling about in frigates and destroyers around the world. Scotty joined in 2010 as Drake mentioned. He's deployed out to the Middle East on HMS Dragon and played an instrumental role in seizing more than £145 million worth of drugs, a record for UK warship in that region. He went on to specialise in the maritime counter-terrorism and interdiction role for many years. He joined 3 years behind him in 2013. He's been operating Wildcat for the last 8 years or so now. He's deployed in many tours to the Middle East, supporting security operations for land-based areas in Oman, and also aboard HMS Kent as well, providing force protection to the Queen Elizabeth carrier and also from HMS Defender. It was the first flight to deploy the Marxist missile. Stable hover, I should say right now, just repositioning. Yeah, once again, they make it look so easy. Of course, plenty of digital assistance on board most modern military aircraft these days, but this can be tricky. But the wind's not too strong to disturb the completeness of this particular flight. One rotor span apart, going into climbing carousel. On top of this, they'll go back into the stable hover and then into a crossing dozer. Good chance for another. There we go. Another great photo opportunity. Slightly different references here. We've had a fixed wing aircraft, the cyclic, not referred to as a stick, because that's controlling the rotor head. And the collective down in their left hand, putting on the power they need. So here we go. Stand by for another nose down. Dramatic stuff. Almost at the end of this particular display now, fantastic sequence from the Royal Navy, both vintage and modern. Maneuvering gently out of sea to come back in and give you another break before one final crossover and departure. Both Scotty and Viv now pilot instructors on the operational conversion unit. That is teaching the Wildcat air crew the art of using and operating maritime strike operations. Stand by for the break. Neatly crossing, coming back in for one final break. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, give them a massive wave off from this fabulous Bournemouth Air Festival. The Royal Navy's Black Cats. with a massive dive down there, bringing up the speed to around about 150 miles an hour. Those girls, they're just braving the elements on the top. Yes, they are real people, and they're going to be doing it upside down and inside out. Putting up there, the girls totally taking it in their stride. As they go through a complete loop, the girls upside down, doing their best. They are, of course, performing their own acrobatics while the boys enjoy some aerobatics. It's great sport, all perfectly safe now. Wasn't much the case about 100 years ago. Business in this, and got together with an extraordinary lady's name called Ethel Dare to come up with the art of wing walking. And here it is today, performed in a very different style, with Dave Farrell leading. Brian Kortz in the other aircraft, and two fabulous girls riding on the top there on those wings. So we've got Kristen and Emma, well known to us all around the circuit. So of course, hugely competitive job, and not just to get in the cockpit of one of these aircraft, but also to get a position up top as well. Many of the girls coming from the circus industry. Kristen herself was a trapeze artist. Developed in the late 30s as well, but a venerable aircraft, but these are not standard. These got uprated engines and also slight modifications to the wings as well. Smoke coming on, all perfectly environmentally sound, of course. Ondina is generally the name of this stuff. And here's the first break in the afternoon. Terrific stuff, rip roaring around the sky at low level. Whilst they're putting G in the cockpit, the girls repositioning themselves on the top of the wings. Well, whilst Alfred there went on to perfect this art, Orlok himself came a bit of a cropper doing this sort of stuff, so not surprisingly, it took a while for the regulations to catch up across the two storming days as well. Aerosuperbatics based on Gloucestershire, super little airfield called RFC, yes, we're flying for the Wake Cup, original First World War airfield. Five of these aircraft now were developed by the owner, Vic Norman. And you can also do it yourself. Just go to the Aerosuperbatics website and you can sign up to go wing walking yourself. Maybe give your partner a treat. Coming back in for another crossover. Let's take a look.
Go!
And that's the sound of Dave Fowle there. And you hear that power coming on. Terrific. So with that extra power, they've also got some up-rated airframes as well, with an additional down. A little bit of a bump, a little bit of an uncomfortable momentarily, bit like over a humpback bridge as they push down, picking up the speed as they pull a bit of G now going up. It'll either be a loop or a roll. Let's see what we're going to do.
Roll.
What a magnificent sight that is. Absolutely terrific stuff. Making use of the fuselage for a bit of extra lift as well. Put it into this knife edge position. Traditional maneuver for Richard Goodwin in the jet pits. And there you hear those jets kicking in. Now that's great news because he had a bit of a hammerheads, longshebacks, the whole bag of unlimited aerobatics, all within a very small space, because this is a really, really maneuverable aircraft. It's essentially based on the Princess US for fuselage, but it's got a lot of tried and tested modifications. One difference being the wing design. design, it's absolutely unique, and it's also got massive ailerons on this, giving more wing area, giving a phenomenal roll rate, but also better low speed handling as well. Giving them a greater opportunity on the upward trajectory to put in a whopping series of maneuvers you're going to see right now. It'll be rolls, yes, flicking either left and right, then tumbling it, and all as a result of that extra power. Going upside down now, using a bit of rudder here to do a turn, hanging in his straps. And in fact, he's not just hanging in, he's ratcheted in, such is the violent maneuver during the course of this display, that any other normal straps would actually work their way loose. So just withstanding a fair amount of negative G there as he comes around. What is extraordinary again about this display is the sheer pace at which he switches from positive to negative G. This back to what Curtis Pitts came up with back in the mid-40s. Taken forward by an extraordinary lady called Betty Skelton. That's hanging upside down in the Smithsonian across the other side of the pond there in Dallas Airport in the extra hangar in Washington DC. Well, it just went on for years, and this is now essentially taking us back and reminding us of all the tremendous Pitts special teams that had in the UK in the late 60s and 70s. Just doing tremendous things. Now, this looks like a normal one, but it isn't. It's not something you can buy off the shelf. Absolutely impossible after this extensive modification program. Right at the heart there, I said it's got a lot of power. Without the jets, it's got an 8.5-litre Lycoming 540 engine, six cylinders, equipped also with a massive smoke system as well. The normal gear has been removed, the engine mount modified, it's got titanium sprung gear legs and a new carbon carriage as well. Modified rudder, looks good too. I mean, it's also got additional yaw controllers as well, and those new wings giving it an amazing roll rate. So that's what's been giving this machine so much extra maneuverability, with a unique style of aerobatics where a high energy gyroscopic force is combined with normal aerobatic maneuvers you can see in the unlimited category that Richard is capable of flying. All under control. It takes you years to get to this level of unlimited standard, however. Masses of practice, and of course G tolerance as well. Even the guy that does it regularly as Richard still has to train for it fairly regularly. It's a hard thing to keep up to speed with, and you can lose it very, very quickly as well. It is the rapidity, as I say, with which he switches from plus to minus, which is one of the really tough parts of this display. Snapping on that positive G again as he literally uses all that power at his disposal just to go straight of the line. You can hear the jump kicking in. Such better two stone speed. And there again, letting the aircraft weight of that engine, that big leader engine, take the weight, heading him back down. Exhausting work, actually. You can imagine putting yourself in a spin dryer or washing machine and selecting the fastest possible speed, tumbling and rolling constantly through the course of around 8 minutes. As well as is Knife Edge Pass. He's also well known for chasing high performance aircraft and runways and ribbon cutting either at limbo low level, or has also done one spectacular operation cutting the ribbon between two air balloons. 9 alongside the Mark 19 here. Please welcome Merlin Formation. Go down on the beach, you'll see their stem trader down there as well. They're giving us great support this year to the Bournemouth Air Festival, clearly showcasing their historic design and engineering excellence and describing the modern pathway to getting involved with engineering, telling the story and commemorating those who fought for the country. Flown today by Alistair Stegg Williams, and alongside him, tour leader Mark Discombe. Of course, most people remember Disco from his DBMF flying and activities. Alistair's team now Supermarine. The speed, a land, style, and panache. That elliptical wing. And the Spitfire. Difference in the course between the 9 and the 19. The 19 carrying the Griffin engine, so that's a distinctive growl. Now, I haven't seen them display this particular play together. Alistair calling the break. An opportunity to see each of these magnificent aircraft. Mark 19, an unarmed high-altitude reconnaissance aircraft, one of a batch of 79 Mark 19s built at Supermarine in Southampton. Powered by 2,000 horsepower Griffin 65 or 66, representing the pinnacle of Spitfire's development in terms of speed, altitude, capability, and a top speed of over 440 miles an hour at 42,000 feet. Earliest air displays of the United Kingdom at Thurs, and sadly lost his life. Rolls-Royce aircraft stabled at their dedicated hangar at East Midlands near Derby, and of course bringing them out during the course of the summer. Alongside their P-51, sadly not with us today, and also at Harvard they use for training as well. Majority of the world, having been completed by Peter Monk and his team, re-registered as GPMNF and operating out of the Biggin Hill Heritage Hangar from 2011 onwards. Classic of his time. Very sad in many ways that R.J. Mitchell did not see the outrageous success that this design and operations achieved. He, of course, sadly died before the outbreak of the Second World War. But easily one of the most recognizable, one of the most iconic and successful fighter designs of all time. Double delta on the Draken there with the inner wing an angle of 80 degrees for high speed performance, with the outer wing it's swept at 60 degrees for better performance at low speeds. Propelled by Svenska Flygmotor RM6BC turbojet ported between 1950 and 1987. Any of those resulting in crashes and destruction of the aircraft. So splitting now, giving... Designs of the canard configuration. Talking about practicality here in the hands of the Swedish Air Force, and they were looking to operate their jet aircraft from reinforced public roads as part of the very good thrust aircraft, and also familiar with the whole range of Swiss aircraft. Great short runway performance. Powered by a single Volvo RM8 turbofan, it's essentially a licensed built variant of the Pratt & Whitney JT8D engine. Difference being the addition of an afterburner. And a thrust reverser, of course, once again to just reinforce that short takeoff and landing maneuver. So typical of Swedish. Don't get to say a great deal doing a typhoon, but generally speaking, we always play a bit of music in the evenings as well for these fantastic displays. Yeah, great shots. Get all those photographs up on Insta and Facebook as well to the Bournemouth Air Festival sites. What a terrific evening. all going very, very quiet. An extraordinary machine, this. Capable of Mach 2, twice the speed of sound. And here you see it now at just 120 knots. It's an awesome machine. Well, the wonders of modern design and technology, and of course digital software all built into that. The canard's twitching away, keeping him safe. And very shortly, I just ram those throttles forward and relight the engines. Squeezing it on as we go through this match rate turn. Absolutely stunning stuff. Skyward, got clearance all the way up. Reheat coming on again. Big G pull, directly vertical. Get a shot of that. Right at the Nigel, right at the end of this sequence, and they're going to be filming that as well as they go down the beach on their way out. But right now, in their proper guise, with the neon lights on, please welcome, once again, the Firebirds. these aircraft, they're RV4s, of course, kit built amongst well over 10,000 of these. Great little touring aircraft, great aerobatic aircraft. And as you can see, they're just slightly modified to take the neon lights and in due course, the pyrotechnics as well. A bit of a light evening for dusk. Dusk can be very dark sometimes, but in this case, we're lighter than perhaps is ideal for these aircraft at the moment. But nonetheless, just a terrific display of formation pairs work at the same time, as also gracefully picking out the shapes in the skies along with the lights. Standard manoeuvres, of course, they just look very different at night, coming through another what we call the half Cuban, putting that a little 180 twist in, as almost as if they were going to go through a loop and then just amending it slightly.
Thank you.
We have a way to go yet, so I'll hopefully give you the cue. Their final fly past and the lights. A few more manoeuvres yet. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Otto. Thank you. absolutely fantastic. Well, we're just going to allow him a couple of minutes now to clear the air.